I'm going to talk about the Global Initiative for Food Loss and Waste Reduction, otherwise called Safe Food, Safe with a V. And I will not spend too much time on introducing the Safe Food Initiative, because that has been done in the recent past so many times. I would rather be interested to give you a more detailed description of the methodology that we have developed to assess food losses and find solutions to food losses in developing countries, in the field. We have developed a new methodology for that, and that's what I want to share with you, and I would like to hear your views and comments on that. If not now, then certainly also later there will be an opportunity. Okay, I'm starting with the first slide, which mentions the title of the initiative, the Global Initiative on Food Loss and Waste Reduction. As in a recent study has last year has shown that about one third of all the food that we produce intended for human consumption finally is not consumed by humans. It's getting lost or wasted before it reaches the consumption stage. This is a short introduction of my position in the Food and Agriculture Organization. From the study we did, I only show you this graph to explain a bit the differences, how we defined it, between food losses and food waste. What we consider as food losses is food products that in their cycle of production in the food supply chain, from agricultural production to post-harvest handling to storage, value-added processing, agro-processing, and wholesaling and retailing along the line, gets lost, spoiled for whatever reason, and never reaches its final product stage. However, food waste is referring to food products who completed their cycle of production, are good food products fit for consumption, and still not being consumed. They are thrown away mostly by retailers and consumers for various reasons. In the graph you see how food is wasted by consumers in seven different regions in the world. And what is striking is that in the industrialized regions of Europe, North America, Japan, China, and South Korea, the food waste is significantly higher. It is about, by consumers, it's about 100 kilograms per year per person, while in the poor regions like Sub-Saharan Africa, South and Southeast Asia, these quantities are almost negligible. Okay. The strategy that we have developed for food loss reduction, it's not really revolutionary, but we are now, contrary to in the past 10, 20 years ago, a much bigger emphasis on the food supply chain approach and making a viable business case. Meaning that food loss reduction has a lot to do with the sustainability of the whole food supply chain, and the problems have to be tackled everywhere in the food supply chain in an integrated way. Because if you only solve a problem in an isolated case, let's say in storage, and because of lack of market access or lack of infrastructure, the food is still getting lost at the later stage, you won't achieve your goal. Meaning we need to have an overview of what is happening in the whole food supply chain. Then the interventions, the solutions to food losses have to be cost effective and not cost in economic terms only. Obviously, the cost of the solution should be lower than the cost of the food loss itself, but also cost effective in environmental terms, nutritional terms. Food losses represent a loss of natural resources and an unnecessary strain on the environment in the course of food production. Land, water is supplied, energy is being used, greenhouse gases are being produced, And if that food is finally not being consumed, this is all in vain. Obviously, also the solution should not put a higher strain on the environment or on the nutritional value. So I give you a few examples also with regards to social and culturally acceptability of food loss reduction measures. These are real cases. 20 years ago, we had in Ghana a project to process tomatoes. In the peak season, in the rural area, tomatoes are abundantly available, more than the market can absorb at that time. And as you know, tomatoes are highly perishable, so a simple village technology was developed for which no electricity was required to put tomatoes, to transform it into tomato paste, and put it in second-hand Coca-Cola bottles and a simple manual capping machine with a cap on it. After this, the product is sterilized in a pot of boiling water. It was a very good product, could easily be kept for 2 years, and that is exactly what happened because nobody wanted to buy it. I mean, from a technology point of view, the problem was solved, but not from a marketing point of view. Finally, the product was still getting lost, because the product was not attractive enough in these bottles. Besides that, the women groups who produced it had no access to the market, so potential buyers would be. Another one is, this is the pounding of cassava into flour, from a project in Zambia, where the pounding of cassava into flour is a laborious job, very heavy, and it's also not so hygienic. The product is prone to contamination with dust and sand, insects, and so on. Therefore, the project provided an hammer mill who could do the job, the pounding of cassava, 10-20 times as fast and also of a better quality. Still, the women in the village pounding the cassava did not use the hammer mill. It was free of charge, it was fully cost effective, so there was no problem of that they didn't use it. They continued to pound manually. And then it was extremely difficult to find out the real reason. Finally, the conclusion was that this pounding of cassava in a group of women has a kind of social function, and this could not be replaced by a very noisy hammer mill somewhere else in the village. The knowledge gap. We know the magnitude of food losses is very high in food supply chains. We know we have a global idea of the causes of food losses. And we also know that finally food loss reduction will have a huge beneficial effect. However, what we don't know is how important are the different causes of these food losses. For instance, if cereals in a rural area get spoiled, both because of the lack of storage facilities as well as the lack of access to the market, then it is very important to know which of these causes is the most important, so that you also know to where you have to direct your interventions. And we don't know precisely what is the impact and the feasibility of food loss reduction solutions. And that is what the part of the Safe Food Initiative is going to concentrate on. The Safe Food Initiative is a collaboration between FAO and its main private sector partner, which is Interpack, which is the biggest industrial fair for the food packaging industry, hosted by Messe Düsseldorf, the Düsseldorf Showgrounds. It's a big organization with offices and activities and fairs in more than 100 countries in the world, and together Messe Düsseldorf and us, FAO, have initiated this Safe Food Initiative, and we are looking for more partners to join the initiative. The program of the Safe Food Initiative for the current biennium, 2012-2013, is a study to the effects of food waste and losses on food prices, from the point of view that if internationally traded commodities like cereals are squandered at a large scale, this could have an effect on the price of these food commodities, also in countries where people cannot afford an increase of food prices. We go to point three, the relationship between food products and the date marking of food products and the food waste, the date labels, best buy date, sell before date of food products, and to what extent is causing food to be wasted, thrown away. Then we have started a worldwide media campaign to raise awareness on the problem, both raise awareness among policymakers, international organizations, institutions, and governments, as well as to the general public. And the whole thing we want to present in regional safe food congresses in Africa, South Asia, Latin America in the end of 2013. What I'm going to concentrate now on is the biggest activity in this program, which is the quantification of the different causes of food losses and analyzing the solutions to reduce them. And we will do that on through a case study approach where we select food supply chains in certain countries, in developing countries. For now, we have started only in Africa and Asia. And the methodology of this work I'm going to discuss now with you in detail. We start with selection of countries and subsectors. This is based on countries and subsectors where existing and ongoing programs of FAO, IFAD, other partners are taking place, and where we can easily collaborate with partners in the field. This is important so that we can easily hook on certain food supply chains and start analyzing the real problems with regard to food losses there without having to discover the whole food supply chain first. We have selected four countries in Africa, which is Kenya, Uganda, Cameroon. This is a mistake. The last one should be Senegal. Kenya, Uganda, Cameroon, and Senegal. And the main subsectors there are maize, banana, dairy, and fish, as well as rice, cassava, poultry, onion, groundnuts, which are important food crops in those countries. In Asia, we have selected Burma, Vietnam, India, and Thailand with the main food supply chains or subsectors, mango, milk, fish, rice, banana, pork, and also fish from aquaculture. After this has been done, we have started the identification of consultants to undertake the studies in the field. A team of two consultants for each subsector will be selected, which should be subsector specialist, preferably an actor in the food supply chain who knows the supply chain very well, a trader, a processor, even a farmer. So, and the second one should be an agricultural economist, mainly to do the economic analysis of the food losses and the impact of their solutions. Then within the subsectors, we have to select the food supply chains. And the food supply chains that we select are always starting with smallholder production. We don't take supply chains that start with large-scale plantation production. Because as FAO, as you know, we are focusing on poverty reduction and food security for smallholder farmers. Then the food supply chain selected should produce a significant scale of produce, contribute to the food production of the country, and preferably include an agro-processing step, and finally be ending at urban markets. The methodology to do this. You understand we do this on a case study basis. We cannot select the whole subsector in a country, because sending consultants into the field for a couple of weeks is extremely expensive. Therefore, we selected a number of food supply chains as cases. And of course, each food supply chain or each case itself has little statistical significance. But the main purpose of our work should lie in, or the main benefit of our work should lie in the quantity of cases of food supply chains that we are investigating. If we can do 20, 30, 40 of these supply chains in each continent, then from the results we hope that we can find certain tendencies and get meaningful information that we can use to develop equally meaningful interventions to resolve problems. The methodology. The methodology, of course, for every food supply chain in every country has to be as uniform as possible so that you can easily compare the results. The methodology that we are developing starts with a preliminary screening of the food losses, and that is based on literature research and expert interviews. I get into detail in the next slide. The next step after the preliminary screening is a survey interviewing of actors in the food supply chain. Then there will be a step of load tracking and sampling, where actually measurements are going to be made. And finally, all this information should lead to a process where we can develop a monitoring mechanism for food losses, as well as identify adequate solutions to reduce the food losses. Each of the four steps will now be discussed in more detail. This is a graphic overview of the same four steps. The screening starts with a review of secondary data and interviews with key informants or experts to get as much information about the whole subsector to start with. Then, to be a bit more accurate, only at this stage, after the screening of the whole subsector has been done, we will select the food supply chain which the consultants are going to investigate in the field. Within the selected food supply chain, we will characterize those points from the secondary data and the key informant interviews. We select those points where the food losses are known to be most important, and where there is the biggest opportunity for a meaningful intervention. We call them critical loss points. Because, as I said, it's expensive to send consultants in the field, so they have to be focused right from the beginning to those points in the food supply chain where the results will have the most impact. Next is the actual planning of the field work, the survey and the sampling method. The survey. That's when the consultants are in the field. They are either at the farming scene, or they move to the traders, or the markets, or the agro-processors. And they make observations, first-hand observations, and they have semi-structured interviews with the stakeholders. Semi-structured interview meaning it's not a preset questionnaire that you hand out to as many stakeholders as possible and you collect the results. No, you have a direct dialogue with one or a group of stakeholders, and you have a checklist of things that you want to discuss, and in the discussion with the stakeholders, more questions and more answers are coming up. And finally, you following your checklist, you'll get to the right answers to your questions. The same applies to key informant interviews. The first interview is more with groups of farmers, traders, and so on. The second one with selected people in the food supply chain. And then finally, after this has been done during a few days, you call everybody together and you do a kind of validation exercise where you discuss with the whole group your findings and you report them. Then you get the load tracking and sampling. You have to now your data and report from the screening and the survey steps. It sets your objective and you choose the loads. What is a load? That is a batch of products that you are going to follow, that you're going to track. It could, for instance, be the produce of a farmer's cooperative during one day or during one week. And all that produce then at the end of the week is being collected by one or more traders on trucks, and they take it to a market or they take it to a processing factory, wherever it goes. That could be a load. It can also be the production of a processor of a batch produced by a processor of a week. Somebody who is drying fish, for instance, the produce of a whole week, and that produce then is going to a market as well. So in this food supply chain that the consultants have selected, they have to choose one or more loads which they're going to track. You have to determine the units of measurement that you're going to sample, or as called the experimental units. This can be a bag of maize, can be a bucket of fish, can be a bunch of bananas, a container of milk. These units, they have to sample in a representative way, take a representative sample, and then from each sample, again, a sample has to be taken that they are going to measure. What do they measure of these samples? The quality, for instance. And they have to make a scale of quality of the products, a scale from 1 to 10, from low, which is completely spoiled, to 10 in optimum condition. Meaning that you can sample from a bunch of bananas, you can sample a few individual bananas and assess that quality and grade it on the scale 1 to 10, 0 to 10 actually. The same with with milk, you can measure the temperature, you can measure the acidity, all these type of things. So all these quality steps have to be defined as well by the consultants. And in that way, you get a qualification of the total quality of the loads. And you will do that at the beginning of the loads, on the moment the loads starts, comes into existence, and you do that at the end, and maybe halfway as well. And you see how the quality of the load changes when the load of product goes from farm to market, or from farm to processor to market. And that is hopefully a way that you can do a quantitative and qualitative analysis of the food loss due to quality problems in this food supply chain. The results, the measurements, they are produced in kilograms, or yeah, mostly in weight units of products with a certain quality characteristic, quality evaluation. Finally, it's very important, this is the most important thing of this exercise, to get into the exercise of analysis of the reasons for these quality deterioration and food losses and the causes. The reasons, first of all, is analyze the reasons for the loss. It can be a physical damage of the products, or pathological contamination with microorganisms, non-compliance with standards, and then a long list of causes, of alternative causes, has to be drawn up, finally, by using their expertise, skills, and knowledge from the obtained from the stakeholders, the actors, identify the real cause of this food losses. And this can be a technological cause, it can have to do with organization of the food supply chain, it can have to do with skills of the actors as well as the infrastructure. The last step is the synthesis, where the results of the first three steps are going to lead into the production of a monitoring, the creation of a monitoring mechanism that we would like to use for future monitoring of food losses, for which specific food loss indicators will be defined. For instance, could be the application of good agricultural practices is an indicator. Rainfall during production, or rainfall during harvest, these are indicators. The availability of packaging materials, these are indicators that contribute to food losses. The ultimate goal is to produce a document that proposes a program to reduce food losses, initially specific for the food supply chain, investigated, but as much as possible extrapolated to the whole subsector in the country. And as well, this also should contribute to a food loss reduction strategy at national level. Thank you for your attention.
Well, thank you very much, Robert, for this interesting presentation. I'm sure there's a whole lot of questions coming in now.
I have questions to two aspects. One is the Safe Food Initiative, Robert. You showed us a program where what you are planning to do with the global initiative, and I would like to know which part the private sector plays in this program, or how the private sector is involved in the Safe Food Initiative. And then my other question is going to the methodology, which I find very interesting. Maybe I just have a comment, it's not a question. We developed our study in Nigeria, just started this week. We developed some questionnaires, so if you're interested, we could send you the questionnaires, and maybe you find them interesting, and maybe you could use some aspects out of it. And the last point is coming to the monitoring. So I would like to know if FAO also plans to revitalize the I don't know the English word, in French it is les feuilles. So to give a monitoring tool to the farmers, how many eggs do they see, or how many larvae or whatever, or butterflies do they see, and when must they act to do something to get this economic level of action. I just forget the English word, but it's Schadschwellenprinzip in German. Maybe Pascal can help me. So I'm interested to know if this will play a role in your monitoring as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Ursula. The private sector involvement in the Safe Food Initiative is very significant. We really recognize that we need to work with the private sector in order to reduce the problem of food losses and food waste. It is the private sector who is affected by these problems. There are the farmers, the traders, the processors, the food industry, the retailers. They are affected by the problems, and they have to solve it. So the only thing that we can do is assisting them in finding ways to solve it. But the final investments has to come from the private sector, and therefore we also need to support the whole program to get to these investment programs. And practically, we like to attract partners in the Safe Food Initiative from the private sector who can support us either in the field with their expertise, if they are there, or just by financing certain parts of the program, like the case studies, the food supply chain studies in the field, as I said, are very expensive. And the more money we get in from our partners, the more of these studies we can undertake. Then on the methodology, I would definitely be interested to see your questionnaire from Nigeria. We had some contact about this before. What we are trying to do here now is to minimize the questionnaire method and do more on direct observation and measurement. Because the disadvantage of questionnaires is that even, especially when you go to rural farmers, they simply don't have records, they don't have data of their own food production and food losses. And therefore, it is extremely difficult to get an accurate assessment from questionnaires. And it is not often these days producing more results than that are already available. So really, with this method that we have developed, we're trying to get a new insight in the problems that are very specific to contribute to food losses. On the monitoring, this is something also that we are yet to work out and to develop. We have started the study in Kenya, actually, and we are hoping to learn a lot from it when the results come from the field, how we indeed can develop adequate indicators that can be used for to make a proper assessment of what food losses are going to be and where we have to be proactive in order to prevent the losses. I cannot say much about it yet. We don't have experience with it yet. This is what we're trying to develop. And again, we would like to really very much welcome everybody who is also working in this area and wants to do something about it, to contribute to this, work with us, so that we can share their experience and their ideas in order to do it as good as possible.
I work in international development programs as an independent consultant, and I've noticed in various areas and regions I've worked in that there's a common theme to large numbers of food wastage problems, and that is failures or inadequate infrastructure, particularly electrical supplies. I noticed that you mentioned in your study you'd be looking at technology, organization, and training, but infrastructure doesn't appear in the list. I was wondering if you're going to be looking at that.
I don't know exactly where you have been looking, that you are missing infrastructure, because we very well recognize this. One of the most important causes of food losses all along the food supply chains, especially in developing countries. So yes, definitely infrastructure and the provision of it, which is in many cases, but not always, in many cases in public function, is one of the things that we have to consider in order to reduce food losses.
Hi, everybody. I'm Nancy Morgan. I'm FAO's liaison for the bank. Robert, great presentation. I think it's really exciting. I just had a couple of questions, and we can go back and forth on this later, perhaps. You know, in terms of the selection of the commodities, I was just wondering, what are the key indicators that you use to select the commodities? I guess I was sort of interested in Cameroon and poultry and smallholder poultry. It would seem like smallholders are usually doing local varieties that they're selling live into markets rather than having small broiler industries. So I was just interested in, when you selected the commodities, how did you select them? And when you go through the analysis, how do you compare the results from different types of production systems? Like in maize in Kenya, if it's highland high rainfall versus other areas. And then I was just wondering the time frame for analysis. When do you think you'll be getting some of the results then? Thanks.
Thank you, Nancy. We select. We have started the selection of the subsectors, and we based it on subsectors in the countries where actually our programs are ongoing. Support programs to these subsectors are ongoing, especially programs from FAO, IFAD, or other partners, NGOs, whatsoever. So we made a right analysis of all countries in Africa and Asia and the most important food subsectors which are there, and then we selected the subsectors where we can easily find partners in the field to support and assist us in this intensive field study. But the first basis, of course, they should be food products. We don't take coffee or tea or tobacco or this type of things. They should be important food products, and they should be of significant scale, and they should start with smallholder production. That is the basis for the selection of the subsectors and the food supply chains. Then, how do we compare the results for different products and in different seasons? Indeed, we are doing case studies, and the meaning, if you do a case study of maize in Kenya this season, that doesn't mean that what you find now will be the same next season, because next season the rainfall pattern can be different, and all kinds of other things can happen with regard to food imports, and I don't know what. At the same time, also, indeed, it's not so easy to compare results from maize in Kenya with fish in Cameroon, for instance. The way we are going to do it, I cannot be very clear about it yet, because it's the first time that we are doing this, but as I said, we really are quite sure that if we have a really good quantity of food supply chains that we have investigated, 20, 30 or 40, that we, looking at the results well, that you can see a certain pattern or tendencies which gives a clear indication of the intervention to be undertaken. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. We have Marcus Bürli's question, you know, that was sent to us via a text message. He couldn't connect to us. He says, thanks a lot, Robert, for the presentation. From SDC, we are currently engaging with FAO on reducing post-harvest losses. Part of that project will be a community of practice on food losses to be hosted by FAO. The Safe Food Initiative will certainly be very relevant in quantifying food losses, but I'm wondering if during the research you'll also try to identify good practices that reduce food losses and how you plan to bring them to scale. That's from Marcus.
Personally involved in this project that we are going to undertake with SEC funding together with IFAD and WFP in Africa on post-harvest losses of cereals, and the community of practice as well. We definitely want to link that community of practice strongly to the Safe Food Initiative, vice versa, to maximize the synergy that can be created. And all the in these field studies, we will by all means identify a lot of good practices and a lot of bad practices, and good experiences and bad experiences, and all of these will be without hesitation fed into the community of practice and shared with the other participants. So I expect a very strong synergetic effect from these two projects.
Okay, I think there's no more raised hands as far as we can see, and if there's no more questions, I want to
see another hand. I saw another hand from Bruno Schuller.
Oh, is it?
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Pascal. Thank you, Robert. My question is, Robert, you showed us that a lot of countries are involved and a lot of food supply change regarding rice and groundnut, onion, etc. So I think it will be a tremendous work to identify all the stakeholders along each of the food supply change. How will you handle this? Have you local experts bringing you to these, let's say, interview partners, etc.? What about the methodology concerning identifying the interview partners? Thank you.
Thank you, too. As I said, we will, for a subsector like groundnut or maize or fish, we'll select one food supply chain. So an area in the country where this production takes place and where the product follows a certain trail to an ultimate market, probably in the city, a nearby city or in the capital. So we need to indeed to identify and in contact quite a number of actors in that food supply chain, the farmers, the traders, the processors, the marketeers, and so on. But we have the consultants who are going to do this are real insiders in the food supply chains. They know them for decades often, and we are selecting food supply chains that are already part of certain ongoing programs in the countries. Programs with the government or with NGOs or with IFAD or with FAO, so that we have a fairly good knowledge about who is active in this food supply chain and where can we find these people so that we can talk to them and make observations and measurements on their products.
Okay, thank you for the explanation. So you are not starting at the scratch. You have your contact partners in the project. Thank you.
Absolutely. That was very essential to have any meaningful results from this, because, as I said, sending consultants into the field is extremely expensive, and if we first have to spend the whole month on exploring the food supply chain, the cost will be too high for us to bear.
Thank you very much. We're getting actually quite long, but if there is more interest, is there anybody else who wants to have a last question to Robert? Otherwise, I would hand over to Robert if he wants to say one more thing. Otherwise, I would thank him from our side and close the session. Robert?
Thank you very much for your attention and the questions raised. For me, the most important thing to come out of this briefing is that I get by email your comments, your contributions, your experiences, and your willingness to be part of this type of studies, if that is possible in the countries that we have selected so far, or if you have ideas of studies you want to undertake in a similar way in other countries. Because if you want to do it, like GIZ is going to do it in Nigeria, he would like to convince all of you to follow a kind of uniform methodology, so that at the end you can compare the results very well. And then more at the overarching level, we are still very much interested in partners to the Safe Food Initiative. And your contribution can either be from a technical experience point of view, as well as from a financial dimension. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.